Good evening. Estimates vary, but relegation from the Premier League could cost Norwich City as much as £3 million. Many of the fans blame this man for relegation. He's club chairman Robert Chase, and he joins us live. But what makes him tick? What does he want from football? And does he really deserve all the blame?
One over here, Sutton, goes! Yes! This is almost fantasy football. And here it is! Norwich City's UEFA Cup journey continues. Norwich City putting out one of the great names of European football.
Chairman's always a problem. If you get a good one, you've cracked it. If you've got a bad one, you're in trouble. In my opinion, he's a bad one. Chase, Robert Chase is a bad chairman.
I mean, he's done a lot of good things at the football club, you know, but I just happen to disagree with him on the policies for the team, and that's as simple as that. We beg to differ, shall we say.
Mm. Bowen battling away. Fed in by Newman, and Robin's well forward, and Goss was well forward too, and Norwich have taken the lead. Jeremy Goss again. Unbelievable stuff.
October 1993. Norwich City's UEFA Cup victory against Bayern Munich in the Olympic Stadium. It's a great night for the club, for manager Mike Walker, and for the man in charge, Robert Chase.
And Norwich are two up.
But just 18 months later, it's all gone badly wrong. Norwich are facing relegation from the Premier League, and Mr. Chase is facing humiliation. One of a new breed of high-profile chairman, he enjoys the limelight, but as he juggles with a controversial business move and a struggling football team, Mr. Chase is under pressure.
This extraordinary general meeting of Norwich City Football Club.
He's helped to build one of the best football stadiums in Britain. But at what price? Critics say Mr. Chase has simply sold all the club's best players, and his luck has now run out. Robert Chase was born and raised in Caister-on-Sea near Great Yarmouth. He went to the Priory School, where a fellow pupil remembers the young Robert as pleasant but unremarkable. He left school at the age of 15 and went to work in his father's building firm. As a young entrepreneur, Robert Chase went on to make money in the building boom of the late 70s and 80s. But today, the building work appears to have slowed up. The accounts for one of his companies, Chase Caister Limited, show that Mr. Chase appears to have invested profits wisely, though. Indeed, he's a man who enjoys all the trappings of wealth. This is Halvergate Hall, his Norfolk base. He also has homes in London and Spain.
His father came along, and my father said, yes, he said, I wouldn't really call him a builder, you know. I don't really say he's a businessman. What I say is that Robert is more of a juggler. He always has something up his sleeve. Then he added, but he has a great flair for making money. I wouldn't be surprised by the time he's 50 that he may be a millionaire, but I'm afraid he won't have too many friends left in the world.
It's Saturday afternoon, and Norwich are playing Liverpool at Carrow Road. With three games left, the Canaries need to win at least two of them to avoid relegation. But many fans, like 84-year-old Sid Sad, have simply had enough.
I'm definitely made up my mind that this will be my last season. It's the fans what keep the club going, not the chairman. He's good at his business, but he knows very little about football. Why have a lovely stadium if you don't have a football team?
Red cards are handed out for the fans to hold up at half-time in a protest organised by David Machin. But one man doesn't like the idea.
That's not necessary.
Why is that, sir?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Yeah. Come on.
Well, it should never be.
Why?
Where's it going to get?
If Robert Chase were to
I've asked two questions. Read those questions. What does it say?
Have you read it? Have you actually read
this time? We want to support the club and the team.
We want to support the club. We support the team. We read this.
I'm aiming to show the board that the supporters have, they've literally had enough and there's got to be changes. Nobody seems to be taking responsibility for what's happened to this club.
Come on, don't be Does that matter?
Beverly Johnson and her daughter Stephanie make a 100-mile round trip from their home near Newmarket. Like David Machin, Beverly wants Robert Chase to resign.
I think he's very arrogant, very self-opinionated, and I wish he would go. I wish he would resign and go and take the board with him. And I think he's been lucky in the past, results have gone his way, but now they haven't, things have changed, and I think he should just go.
Darling, you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go? If you say that you are mine, I'll be here till the end of time. So you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go?
Norwich City lose the match, and while some fans debate whether Mr. Che should stay or go, others are in no doubt. Robert Chase is no stranger to controversy. In 1987, he sacked club manager Ken Brown.
I know I've got nothing to feel ashamed about. I've done my utmost. I love this club, and it'll always be a part of me. No doubt about that.
What about your own future?
I'm here to stay. That's not in doubt.
The decision to sack Ken Brown angered some shareholders who forced a vote of no confidence in the chairman, a vote Mr. Chase survived.
I don't think he knew anything about football. I'm not sure he knows anything now about football. I think he's been a very, very fortunate person these past years, very fortunate in a football situation. He's, the supporters of other things that matter, really, and it appears that he doesn't listen to them, not at all. And that's the sorrowful part about it.
If Ken Brown's departure was controversial, then Mike Walker's resignation and subsequent flight to Everton was more so. Walker left Carrow Road because Robert Chase couldn't or wouldn't offer him more job security.
I thought I'd earned the right to have a bit more money as well, but he didn't see it that way. And if he doesn't see it that way and he's the governor and he runs the club, that's fine. You know, I mean, you know, people seem to get upset about it. At the end of the day, the only thing I did, I just got upset about it and said, right, that's it, I'm finished, I'm out. And people don't seem to be able to accept that. You know, they say, well, you shouldn't have gone. Well, why shouldn't I go? Why should I work for nothing? Because that's effectively what it is. And it's all right saying, well, get this bonus and get that bonus. You're going to get 400,000. But the point is, on the other hand, you're selling me best players. How am I expected to win things if you're selling me best players?
Robert Chase has overseen the selling of close to £24 million worth of talent in his 10 years at Carrow Road. Imagine a team of players who have left the club. Woods in goal, a back four of Bruce, Watson, Linegan and Phelan. Fox, Sherwood, Townsend and Phillips in the midfield with Fleck and Sutton up front. A team even capable of winning the Premier League, perhaps.
Some clubs have to be net sellers of players to survive. All that's been done at Norwich City, I think, has been done on an average profit over the last 10 years of about £150,000 a year. Now, that's not a great deal when you think of some of the bigger clubs that Norwich have to compete against.
Paddy Manifold, a teacher at Gorleston near Great Yarmouth, has been a Norwich City fan for close on 40 years.
When you look at the critics of Bob Chase, what was it like when he took over? Ramshackle wooden ground, people going round with blankets at half time, scrounging money off the fans to pay the players, and Robert Chase came into this with nothing. There was nothing there. The shares were so worthless that it cost more to have them transferred than they were worth. If you go back in history, he's the most successful chairman Norwich have ever had.
Mark Busby told me years ago, he says, Tommy, sell your best players, you'll win nothing. You'll be buying trouble.
And he's right.
If I was Chase tomorrow in his position, I would bring Mike Walker back tomorrow.
The pressure on Robert Chase is growing. At a fundraising event in Norwich, Tommy Docherty, the former Manchester United manager, now football pundit and raconteur, is highly critical of the Canaries chairman.
I blame 75% of it, I blame the chairman, yeah. Of course I do. No doubt about it, he's the man to blame. He should have held on to Mick Walker when they had a good manager. The thing that surprises me, well, it doesn't surprise me, the thing that I laughed at was that Robert Chase says, if Chris Sutton's not here at the beginning of the next season, I wouldn't be here. Chris Sutton wasn't there, but the chairman's still there. You can't. If you sell your bad, if you sell your good players, you finish up with a bad team. The danger is they could go right through the leagues. Because you see, when you go down, the players that you've got at the moment who are the better players in Norwich City, they won't want to play in the Ensley League. When their contract comes up for renewal, they'll be off. And that's the danger. It's like a cancer. Once it gets a grip of the club, it just goes right through the club. And it's difficult to halt, difficult to stop.
As we now line up to start this very important Premiership game, is this another chapter to be written into the history of Norwich City Football Club? We will know at the end of this game as Jerry Goss starts us off. Back to Ian.
Norwich
Brooking
are away at Leeds, a game the Canaries must win to stay in the Premier League. At home, Sid Sadd waits anxiously.
Three players with him. McAllister, though. Chance here now comes through the middle. Oh, it's headed. A chance. And Ward must score. He does. Ashley Ward has put it in the back of the net. A dreadful mix-up for the Leeds. On the edge of the area still. On Yeboah. Still Yeboah. Polson's there asking for a penalty. Not given. Yes, he's given a penalty. He said John Polston has pulled down Yeboah. They've given Leeds a penalty. I do not believe this. McAllister against Marshall. In comes McAllister on his right foot, shoots, and he puts it in the back of the net. Leeds 1, Norwich 1. And that really is disaster for Norwich. Sharp, Sharp outside the area, delivers it in first time, and Sharp, and it's in the back of the net. Yes, it's Carlton Palmer who puts it into the back of the net to give Leeds 2, Norwich 1. So Norwich City have ended their reign in the Premiership. They will go to the Ensley League now.
Next season, the Canaries will join Luton Town in the First Division of the Ensley League, where life is very different from life in the Premier League. On the same weekend that Norwich are relegated, Luton play Stoke at Kenilworth Road. It's harder to make ends meet here. Income from television rights, ticket sales and merchandising can fall, and the Luton chairman says that if you go down, it isn't easy to get back up.
It's a harder game because what you lose in terms of skill, you make up in physical aggression. If you have skillful players, it is difficult for them to flourish in this league because there are teams that will go out and kick lumps at them. Robert Chase has done a tremendous job at Norwich. The fans might be upset they got relegated, but he's done a tremendous job. You look at that stadium, you look at the success that Norwich have had, with no real divine right in terms of the numbers of people that support them. And they've only done it because of Robert's being there. If he hadn't been there, Norwich wouldn't have had their success. So, you know, it's not the chairman's fault. Look at the success. See what success Norwich has had. That's what Robert Chase has given Norwich.
Not all Norwich City's recent problems are on the pitch. Some fans are asking difficult questions about events off it. Over the years, Robert Chase has been buying himself club shares and thereby tightening his grip on Carrow Road. Club accounts for the year ending June 1993 show that R.T. Chase increases his holding in the company to over 41,000 shares from 28,000 shares. Robert Chase continues to build up his shareholding throughout 1994. Buying through his building company, Chase Caister Limited, he's responsible for half of all the transactions made in that year. The city chairman is slowly increasing his control in the club, but to what ultimate end? Norwich City are planning a stock market flotation to help secure the club's financial future. But of course, any successful flotation could make Mr. Chase a very rich man indeed. Before Norwich can float, the club have to tidy up the share register. Shareholders are offered £12 for each share, a price considered too low by some.
Mr. Chase is on record saying he's paid far more than £12. He declined to indicate what the price was. But if that's the case, why? I mean, I think most people would agree that £12 a share is derisory.
Roy Rudling wanted to sell 100 shares last year and contacted Norwich City's company secretary, Trevor Nichols.
I asked him what I could get. And he said, well, you set your price. Do you want £30, £25, £20? And I said I'd be satisfied with £20. And a few days later, received a cheque for £2,000. I was quite surprised that it was signed by Robert Chase, Caister Limited. I was under the impression that it would be a supporter who had bought the shares and not the chairman of the club.
So if you got £20 for them and you think you perhaps could have got more, what's your view on the people who have sold shares for £12 recently?
I feel very sorry for them. I think they've been almost robbed. The shares are worth much more, and especially if they're going to float them on the stock exchange.
Robert Chase bought a total of 2,177 shares in the year ending June 1994. Accounts for Chase Caister Limited in the same year show investments worth £56,895. If all that was spent on buying the Norwich City shares, they cost Mr. Chase an average price of £26 each. So, how much are the shares really worth? We commissioned accountant Jim Greenfield to look at the share price. With club assets in excess of £20 million, he believes the shares are worth much more than £12.
In the context that the shares are going to be floated on the stock market one way or another and traded, the share valuation is way too low, in my opinion. When I looked at it, I came to the conclusion that the share value was very low, because the assets behind the shares are worth a lot of money. A good average price would probably be somewhere in the region of 10 times the price that was being quoted, £12 per share.
If the shares are floated on the stock exchange, John Shelley is one man who might buy them. A senior fund manager with Abtrust, Shelley is responsible for UK shares worth in excess of £300 million. But he's sceptical about Norwich City's chances of success.
A good season can be followed by a bad season, where you have bust-ups between management, players breaking legs, what I call a Klinsmann effect, he joins, he leaves. People can't stand volatility. The city likes predictability, and often football clubs don't offer predictability or enough predictability.
I've said quite clearly that the buck stops with me. It always does stop with the man at the top. I wouldn't have it any other way.
He's obviously a very colourful character, and he's got a lot to prove on any flotation, because he'll have to be more open as to his future plans. And my guess is in the past he's not been as open because he didn't have to be.
One question the financial institutions might want answering relates to this sentence in the club accounts. R.T. Chase is interested in the supply of technical services to the company by a business of which he is a director. In other words, Mr. Chase is supplying something to the football club. But what exactly, and for how much? We looked through the accounts of Mr. Chase's companies, but couldn't find the answer. A one-all draw in the last match of the season is too little, too late. And after the final whistle, thousands stay inside the ground to protest against Robert Chase. But the real trouble erupts later, outside the ground, when a group of about 200 or 300 block Carrow Road. Mounted police are brought in to clear the crowd. It's a chaotic conclusion to a sad story of decline. Yet, Robert Chase remains defiant to the bitter end. He will not resign.
Mr. Chase, it's been said that the reason your manager didn't buy players is because you wanted to keep the money in the bank to make any share flotation more successful. Is that right?
Well, could I first thank you for inviting me to come along to your programme, and doing it this way without it being recorded gives us a wonderful opportunity to discuss all the issues you've raised this evening in a very free and open way. Now, to answer your question just as positively, I think the premise you start from may be mistaken. I looked very carefully through the figures before I came out this evening, and if you take into account the levies and the costs of bringing players to Norwich, in the last 15 or so months, we've spent nearly £6 million on bringing players to Norwich. You've done a wonderful research job this evening. You know that figure is correct. So the premise you start from on your first question, I believe on reflection, fails.
The share price, £12, mm-hmm. Far too low.
Well, I don't really want to get into that because the articles of association of the company, not that I was in any way involved in producing those, sets out quite clearly the procedure to be adopted. And the club has followed that procedure precisely. The value of the shares is a view that you're perhaps entitled to take. But at the end of the day, the articles which we're bound by say it's a matter for the auditors to arrive at the value, and their decision is not questionable.
Sure. OK, well, our auditor said they might be worth as much as £120.
Well,
so why were the shareholders only offered £12?
I think it really depends on what you're valuing. We were valuing shares in blocks of less than 250, and the vast majority of them were in twos and threes or 20s.
Sure, so, but when you bought 100 shares from Roy Rudling, you offered him £20. Why not at least offer the shareholders that?
I wonder if you could just let me finish answering the question. You asked me to come along.
Sure.
Perhaps you could do me the courtesy to allow me to finish answering the question.
Yes, of course.
I was saying that the shares were really dealt with very small blocks. We had some 500 shareholders who owned less than, say, 10 or 15 shares. And they were really the people we were mainly dealing with. And the valuation took that into account. But we were bound clearly by the articles, and we followed that procedure precisely.
But I come back to my original question. Roy Rudling's parcel, relatively small, 100 shares. You offered him £20.
That doesn't stop anyone. Shares are assets that can be freely traded. What we were dealing with was valuing them under the procedure set out in the articles. People have bought and sold shares absolutely freely. They're assets that can be traded openly and freely. And whatever price one wishes to buy or sell them, it's entirely a matter for them. You mustn't muddle the two issues.
Okay.
One is the procedure set out in the articles, and the other is the market. Mm. And the marketplace operates freely.
Fair
and we
enough.
Wouldn't have it any other way.
Fair enough. As we showed in the film, mm-hmm. you've been buying shares like there was no tomorrow.
Well,
why?
I don't agree with that at all.
Why?
I've been buying shares, and I've made it quite clear that I would wish to continue buying shares. Mm-hmm. I take a great interest in the football club, and I don't intend to part or sell my shares at all. Every time any have come available, and I've made it quite clear that I would wish to buy them.
All right. What's the most you've paid for a share?
Well, I don't think I'd want to talk about what my own personal affairs are, but I've said shares are a commodity that can be freely traded, and it's a matter between the buyer and the seller.
You see, the problem is this, Mr. Chase, that some people suspect your motives. They say that in any share flotation, you stand to make a lot of money.
Yes.
Isn't that true?
I think they suspect my motives. I arrive at Carrow Road generally between 7 and 8 most mornings, and you know that the times you've telephoned me, I'm there frequently between 8 and 10 in the evening.
Indeed, you work very hard.
I haven't missed a home game or away game. Does that reflect my motives? I care passionately about the club, and being relegated has been just as disappointing for me as it has been for any of the supporters.
I'm glad you raised how hard you work. I think what a lot of people are very curious about is what you actually get back in financial terms for all your hard work.
I'm really glad you've actually asked me that. What I get back for it is a great deal of pleasure. The sort of pleasure that you and I enjoyed in Denver when we were there last year. The sort of pleasure that you and I enjoyed in Inter Milan.
Absolutely.
The sort of pleasure that we've enjoyed together, not just you, but many of our supporters. They've been absolutely great times.
RT Chase is interested in the supply of technical services to the company by a business of which he's a director. Let's clear that one up. Technical services, what are we talking about here?
Well, I think that the accounts you have to disclose, and rightly too, if a company that you're involved with supplies anything to the company. And the way that that's recorded in the accounts complies precisely with the Act. If it had been material, that would have to have been set out in detail. But it's very sensible.
But can you give us an idea of what monies you receive? What do you pay?
As a salary.
Yes.
Well, the salaries of directors are clearly set out in the accounts. And you can
see. What do you get?
And you can see last year in the accounts that the directors earned something less than £30,000, which included all insurances and all expenses that has to be disclosed. Mm.
So I hear a rumour, I hear a rumour that you earn a six-figure sum. You pay yourself a six-figure sum. Is that right?
Can I knock that on the head? Absolutely now. That's nonsense. And I'm very glad you've asked me that because it gives me an opportunity to clear it up swiftly and positively. And thank you for putting that to me. And that was the advantage of coming on this evening and having the opportunity of doing that. I'm very grateful to you.
And thank you. We only have a minute left. I won't ask you if you'll resign because I know the answer.
Yeah.
But under what circumstances might you resign?
Well, at the moment, there's a massive task ahead. I want to see Norwich as quickly as possible bounce back in the Premier Division. Now, what you've got to remember is that I stood on the terraces. I stood at the Barclay end when I wore short trousers. And I'm just as much as a supporter of
anybody. The trouble is, Mr. Chase, you've been relegated. Protest. It doesn't get much worse than this, surely. Or does it?
Well, we've had some fantastic times. You mustn't forget those. All clubs.
You've had some bad times recently as well.
Well, since Christmas, it has been a bit tough. But Manchester United went through this. Newcastle had far worse times than we've had. And look how they've bounced back to be a magnificent club. And we will do just the same.
Mr. Chase, we have to leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me along this evening.
Pleasure.
I'm most grateful.
That's it. Good night.
If you have comments you'd like to make about that programme, you can phone the viewers hotline on 0345